It's Christmas Eve 1906, and from Brant Rock, a wind-lashed signalling station in Massachusetts, a momentous sound is heard. It's the first ever wireless broadcast of a piece of recorded music. Handel's Largo, transmitted by an intrepid radio pioneer, Reginald Fessenden. From these small, crackly beginnings, a global industry would soon grow. This historic broadcast ushered in a new age for music, an age when music would belong to everyone, everywhere, often, as it was in this case, enjoyed completely free. Radio and its close relation, the gramophone record, had a completely unexpected effect. While many hours of classical music were recorded and broadcast, most of all, radio and records helped local forms of folk music find a global audience for the first time in history, especially American folk music based around the blues. The invention of new recording techniques and the rise of the popular music that benefited from them is the big story of the last 100 years in music. Thanks to radio play, gramophone records, and now the internet, popular music has swept the planet. The advent of free-to-air music for the world's grateful millions would change the value, purpose, and style of music more dramatically than any other development in history. The popular age, as it rapidly became, brought undreamed-of musical rewards to humankind. But it's also thought by some to have brought about the near extinction of what came to be known generically as classical music. But is it true that classical music has been suffocated in its sleep? I'd say not. And I think what's happened is more interesting. Classical music has changed and morphed into other forms. Its DNA is everywhere you care to look in the popular mainstream. Not that the classical music world always welcomed this development. Trite, feeble, vapid, lifeless, derivative, stale. This was the highbrow critic's assessment of the musical climax of a concert that took place in New York City in February 1924 in Aeolian Hall, a premier venue for serious symphonic music. What happened, though, was that the event was hijacked. A genius premiered a work he'd composed in 5 weeks, and by the end of its 14 minutes, music's goalposts had been irrevocably shifted. The point of the concert was educational, to demystify the classical shrine of Aeolian Hall for people who liked jazz, and to show connoisseurs of classical music that the upstart genre of jazz could work in a proper concert hall setting, as if to say, one day jazz will grow up and will be respected like Beethoven. The reception given to Rhapsody in Blue encapsulated the polarised attitudes of the next 50 years. High art critics panned it, the audience loved it. Great music has a way of finding its voice whatever snobbery throws at it. And what happened next is that Gershwin's first recording of Rhapsody in Blue sold 1 million copies in a year. Rhapsody in Blue is now one of the standard pieces in every orchestra's repertoire, an out-and-out modern classic. What the 20th century teaches us is that if you give music a nationality, a frontier, a class, a racial badge or a stylistic label, it'll break out of it, spectacularly. Even Rhapsody in Blue itself is difficult to pin down. Is it classical music, or jazz, or both? Just as there's no one thing that can be labelled classical music, the same is true for many popular genres, jazz perhaps most of all. From the very beginning, jazz as a style eluded definition, so various were its manifestations in different places. It's hardly surprising that a genre which defied form, which chose improvisation over the printed page, which allowed maximum freedom and looseness in its harmony, its interpretation of melody and its rhythm, should have splintered into 100 colourful shards on impact with the world. In the 20s and 30s, the records of Louis Armstrong, Fats Waller, Duke Ellington and many others were eagerly listened and danced to across the world. But there was another aspect to jazz that set a tone for popular music in the 20th century. From its earliest days, it appeared to belong equally to musicians of all races, bucking the segregated trend of 20s and 30s society. But while popular music went from strength to strength, classical music seemed to be losing its way. It began the 20th century with both prestige and popular appeal. How fast things had changed. As late as 1926, the unveiling of a new piece by the last great composer of Italian opera, Giacomo Puccini, was a media event on a global scale. Turandot was performed to huge audiences, and its standout number, you may have heard it, became an instant standard. With the exception of a handful of later works by American composers John Adams and Philip Glass, newly written operas became more or less invisible to the population at large, even as the audience for revivals of old operas grew and grew. A newly composed classical opera in the late 20th century was like beluga caviar, a shockingly expensive product from an endangered species, accessible to a very few privileged people and all but irrelevant to anyone else. So how did this come about? Avant-garde classical music began to set out on a radical new path in the early years of the 20th century. All the arts, as a response to the sheer speed and intensity of modern life, sought to abandon representational forms in favour of abstraction. Just as modern life became more and more fragmented, bewildering and unsettling, so too cutting-edge classical music became jagged and discordant to reflect the changing world. Composers like Arnold Schoenberg, Alban Berg and Anton Webern began to abandon the traditional building blocks of Western music. They put in place a new system variously called atonalism, 12-tone or serialism. Serialism aimed to do away with the sense of home in any given piece of music by treating each of the 12 notes in the Western scale as equals, not allowing any of them to be repeated, so your ear couldn't latch on to one of them as the centre of gravity. It was as radical a formula for music as it would be for a language if you ruled that no letter of the alphabet could be used more than once in a sentence. Schoenberg's complicated theorem, though, was only one possible way forward for experimental classical music as the popular age gathered momentum. Another option was to become the oral manifestation of the surreal and give up on any definable meaning. The term surrealist was first used to describe a 1917 ballet staged in Paris. Parade was a clownish concoction cooked up by composer Eric Satie, painter Pablo Picasso, and writer Jean Cocteau. Parade was not without its innovations. These included the juxtaposition of seemingly unrelated scenes, the disruption of any expectation of a narrative, and its integration, against the composer's wishes as it happens, of non-musical sound effects into the score. The rhythmic qualities of these sounds, from typewriters to factory sirens, were to be exploited time and time again as the 20th century wore on. But the timing of a buffoonish circus piece like Parade, May 1917, seems now tasteless and incomprehensible. At the very same time that this tomfoolery was unfolding in Paris, just 100 miles away on the Western Front, 120,000 French lives were being lost in one of the bloodiest battles of the Great War. How cut off from reality had high art become that anyone deemed the slapstick camp of Parade, which has all the hallmarks of a hastily thrown together student review, an appropriate public offering while this was going on? But there was another way for classically trained composers to go. They could find common cause with the popular, and by so doing, cross-fertilize their idiom with the commercial mainstream. This alternative route for classical composers can be seen emerging in the 1920s in Germany. Here, the hangover from the First World War was felt most acutely, with hyperinflation, mass unemployment, and running street battles between communists and fascists. To address the political malaise, an edgy, politically charged cabaret style was born in Berlin. The composer who gave the style its hallmark was the classically trained Kurt Weill. He shot to recognition in 1928 with an opera slash musical slash play written with the communist playwright Bertolt Brecht. It was the Threepenny Opera. Set in the criminal world of 18th century Soho, complete with thieves, beggars, prostitutes and pimps, the Threepenny Opera's message is that the corruption, money-grubbing, violence and cynicism of the underclass is really no different to the wider values of capitalist society. It begins with a murder ballad introducing the central character, the charismatic, murderous gang boss, Mackie Messer, whose name in English was Mac the Knife.
Und der Haifisch, der hat Zähne, und die trägt im Gesicht. Und Mackie, der hat ein Messer, doch das Messer sieht man nicht. Und Schmulmeier liebt verschwunden, und so mancher reicher Mann, und sein Geld hat Mackie Messer, den man nichts mehr weiß.
The Threepenny Opera was a kind of train spotting for the late 20s, presenting to its middle-class audience a grimy, no-frills vision of the alienated underclass. In Depression-era Europe, it clearly struck a chord, since by the time Weill fled Germany for the States in 1933, it had been translated into 18 languages and performed more than 10,000 times. Here was a form of accessible music in the shape of a drama that did mean something and had plenty to say about the times it was written in. What's remarkable is how, during the Depression era and the rise of fascism, it was popular music, rather than serious music, that became the voice of conscience. Even in the musical, so often a byword for escapism.
I love you, Poggy. Don't let him take me.
A key example of a musical with a message is Porgy and Bess by George Gershwin, with lyrics by his brother Ira and playwright DuBose Heywood. Set in a poverty and drug-stricken African-American fishing community in the South, Porgy and Bess was notable for its sympathetic but clear-eyed portrayal of underclass life.
With you,
the fact that three white men wrote Porgy and Bess has caused unease ever since it was written. It's fair to say, though, that no such controversy prevented some of the greatest African-American artists of the century from recording versions of its superbly crafted songs.
Summertime, and the living is easy.
Yeah, it ain't necessarily so. It ain't necessarily so.
What Gershwin's songs were doing was redrawing the parameters of what subjects popular songs might tackle. The challenge was taken up with Unforgettable Power in Strange Fruit, recorded by Billie Holiday in 1939. It wouldn't generally be found on any music degree syllabus, but it may be one of the pieces of music with greatest individual impact of its time.
Bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves, and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
Strange Fruit, written by a communist poet, Abel Mirapol, is thought to have been prompted by an unbearably graphic newspaper photograph of the lynching and hanging of two black men in Indiana in 1930. A horror that was a disturbingly common occurrence in America at the time, but not one anybody had yet thought to describe in song.
Scent of magnolia, sweet and fresh. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh.
Holiday's haunting performance and the distressing poetic text of Strange Fruit marks the moment when popular song could no longer be dismissed as frothy commercial fluff, when it began to assume a more mature role in society's examination of itself.
For the sun to rock, for the tree to drop. Here is a strange and bitter cry. Classical
music went through a stage in the 1920s when composers took to rummaging around in music's back catalogue, mischievously writing pastiche in the style of previous eras. It was as if experimentation and modernism had simply run out of steam, to be replaced with the musical equivalent of repro furniture. But then a startling, extraordinary new sound was heard, and it came from a composer who had form when it came to musical revolutions. It was Stravinsky, the lord of misrule himself, who took a leap in the dark and broke free, both from the zany world of the surreal and from ye oldie worldie of pastiche. He gave a bracing new direction to the classical tradition. As is often the case, the most original, daring and influential works are ones that creep up on the world, apparently out of nowhere. One such is Stravinsky's complicated 1923 ballet, Les Noces, staged in Paris, based around a Russian peasant wedding. At times, the role of the voice is like the modern technique of rapping. The nature of the rest of the ensemble is more startling still, a large battery of percussion instruments, including four pianos. The resulting jangling, sparklingly dissonant sound, which is brittle, full of edgy attack and a kind of out-of-tune resonance, would have been literally unimaginable, even terrifying to audiences of the day. One contemporary critic described Les Noces, the wedding night, as enough to convert intending brides and bridegrooms to celibacy. But to other composers, this sound seems startlingly fresh, like someone had uninvented the symphony orchestra and started again from scratch. The sound world of Les Noces is, quite simply, the most imitated of all 20th century combinations outside the fields of jazz and popular music. By the time Les Noces was written, Mussolini had taken power in Italy, and the Nazi Party was beginning its rise to power in Germany. When Hitler became Chancellor in 1933, musical works written by communists, like Bertolt Brecht, Jews, like Kurt Weill and many Broadway composers, and African Americans, the creators of blues and jazz, were banned in the Third Reich, labelled as degenerate music. So how did classical composers respond to the Nazis' cultural policies? Some were lucky enough to escape. Few who stayed put challenged the regime. Thing classical music had to a true dissident in the 1930s was the Hungarian modernist Béla Bartók, who forbade all performances or broadcasts of his music in the Third Reich and fascist Italy, a gesture which impoverished him, and who actually asked for his name to be added to a Nazi list of so-called degenerate musicians intended for public ridicule and ignominy. To continue having their music performed, composers who remained in Germany had to stay on the right side of the regime, even if they didn't always actively support it. For the now elderly composer Richard Strauss, the most prestigious cultural figure in the Third Reich, his struggle seemed to be confined to how to handle the Nazi bigwigs so that they'd leave him alone. This was clearly more important to him than tackling them, for example, on the disgusting racial policies. In his own field alone, Jewish musicians had been ejected from orchestras, universities and conservatoires, and the music of Jewish composers, alive or dead, had been prohibited. One composer who had no qualms about working uncritically with the Nazi regime wrote what has become a much-loved staple of the classical repertoire. Carmen Carmina Burana had its tumultuously successful premiere in the Third Reich in 1937. Orff accepted the Nazi government's request to replace the Jewish Mendelssohn's incidental music to A Midsummer Night's Dream. He appeared powerless to intervene on behalf of a close friend who was tortured and executed by the regime, and he lied to the Americans after the war about having been involved in the resistance, which he was not. The reverse side of the totalitarian coin, the Soviet Union, was just as eager to control the arts. From 1936, Stalin's cultural henchmen rigorously prohibited any sign of modernism in music. This hardening of official attitudes caused huge difficulty for Russia's leading composer, Dmitri Shostakovich. A modernist at heart, after one of his works was officially labelled Chaos, Not Music, he had little choice but to write in the approved Soviet manner or run the risk that he and his family might end up in a prison camp. But then, when Germany invaded the Soviet Union in 1941, the agendas of Stalin and his composers were all of a sudden newly aligned. Composers' purpose and cause became patriotism. After several decades of dislocation from the mainstream audience, leading composers once again began to write music that engaged with the musical tastes and hopes and fears of ordinary people living through the agony of war. Perhaps the most dramatic example of a large-scale work of patriotic intent was Shostakovich's Leningrad Symphony, premiered in March 1942, dedicated to the people of his home city, at that time enduring an apocalyptic siege. The siege of Leningrad, modern-day St. Petersburg, cost more lives than any other battle of the war. So desperate were conditions that in the winter of 1941, there were outbreaks of cannibalism. A score of Shostakovich's Seventh Symphony was dropped by plane into the city, and a scratch orchestra was assembled to broadcast its message of patriotic defiance. It was played on loudspeakers throughout the devastated city, as well as outwards to the enemy lines, and performed and broadcast all over the Soviet Union. Before retreating from Leningrad in January 1944, German troops were ordered to loot and destroy its historic galleries, mansions and palaces, and a huge haul of treasure was taken back to Nazi Germany. One cultural item they couldn't pillage, though, was Shostakovich's Seventh Symphony, Leningrad. In the USA, musical patriotism took a rather different form.
I'll be marching to a love song while you're waiting for me.
Once America entered the war at the end of 1941, a massive hearts and minds operation was put in place to educate and entertain both troops and public.
Even though we're apart, I'll be marching to a love song.
And it wasn't just popular music that was pressed into service. One of America's leading composers, Aaron Copland, captured the public mood in his 1944 ballet, Appalachian Spring. Audiences adored Appalachian Spring with its touching innocence and optimism, embodied in its cleverly integrated 19th century Shaker hymn tune, Simple Gifts. Appalachian Spring stirringly expects American victory in the war and the ushering in of a better age, reflected in the sincere and uncynical values of the pioneer rural communities it celebrates. Here it is, danced by the choreographer who commissioned it, Martha Graham. Like Stravinsky's Firebird and The Rite of Spring, Prokofiev's Romeo and Juliet or Ravel's Bolero, all riotously successful, Appalachian Spring was composed as a ballet score. Why is this significant? Because it's hard to imagine what 20th century classical music would have done without dance. It was as if the distraction of telling a story, reaching an audience, or submitting to the structure of another art form liberated composers from the necessity to impress academics, musicologists, or worse still, each other with musical navel-gazing. Don't get me wrong, this sort of avant-garde music did find an audience. But in the 1950s, cutting-edge, new music began to take a strange direction, going even further than the radicals of the 1920s. With whole pieces being made up of found sounds and musical decisions being made by the toss of a coin or the mood of the musician. The high watermark of this movement has to be John Cage's creating in 1952 a piece called 4 minutes 33 seconds, consisting of the player or players doing nothing for that length of time, treated ever since by the classical music high command as a significant musical event. The piece was in three movements. Here's an excerpt from the second. While all this was going on, it was the American musical, inspired in part by the lead shown by the Threepenny Opera, that began to comment on the social conditions of post-war America.
Buying on credit is so nice.
One look at us and they charge twice.
I have my own washing machine.
What will you have, though, to keep clean?
Skyscrapers bloom in America. Cadillacs bloom in America. Industry boom in America.
12 in a room in America.
West Side Story, composed by the classically trained Leonard Bernstein with lyrics by a young Stephen Sondheim, had instant impact, full as it was of great tunes, influenced by jazz and popular styles. Its audience, though, 50 years earlier, would most likely have been going to the opera instead. In the 50 years since West Side Story, the musical has gone from strength to strength, finding an audience of millions that Gilbert and Sullivan could only have dreamed of. The musical filled the vacuum that had been created by opera's turning away from the accessible and popular style it had pursued since the 1630s. So can classical music ever regain its central position in people's emotions and affections? I think it already has, but it's done so in surprising ways. Just when it looked as if classical music might be sleepwalking to oblivion, along came a knight in shining, indeed silver, armour. the 20th century's own medium, cinema. One of the first examples of a collaboration between a major classical composer and a filmmaker of genius was Prokofiev's groundbreaking score for Eisenstein's Alexander Nevsky from 1938. Although many classical composers had a go at writing for the cinema, for the most part it was specialist film composers who were prepared to subordinate their music to the requirements of the film. Even a comic strip gothic thriller like Batman, aimed at a mass audience, featured a full-on orchestral score, classical in all but name, composed by the brilliantly quirky Danny Elfman, which made the action sequences thrilling and dark. If anyone tells you classical music is dead in the 21st century, all it means is that they don't go to the cinema. While classical music in cinema thrived, popular music post-war wasn't standing still. Better microphones and recording techniques, the arrival of the long-playing record, and in particular a new breed of musical virtuoso, were all laying the groundwork for the blossoming of electrifying new popular forms. One of them was the jazz style known as bebop, the frantic, somersaulting groove of the late 40s and 50s, where whole tracks were devoted to helter-skeltering instruments, sometimes solo, sometimes in coordinated groups, tumbling across notes at high speed, willfully oblivious of the harmonies they once belonged to. If death-defying off-piste skiing at high altitude down near vertical slopes had a musical equivalent, this would be it.
Salt peanuts, salt peanuts. Salt peanuts, salt peanuts.
In the music of Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, and Dizzy Gillespie, bebop became the most influential form of jazz in the 50s and beyond. Whilst bebop relied for its forward momentum on giddy chaos, other forms of popular music wanted to go in the other direction, towards a raucous, thumping regularity. Rocket 88 was released in 1951. It's generally reckoned to be the first rock and roll record. Unlike the unpredictability of bebop, rock and roll's appeal lay in the clockwork rigidity of four beats to a bar. Jazz was for cool dudes to listen to, rock and roll was for teenagers to dance and date to. And teenagers suddenly existed, apparently, after 1950.
Smart and designed, black convertible top, and the gals don't mind. Sporting with me riding on.
Not only did teenagers now exist, the affluent society that was America and eventually Europe in the post-war period saw teenagers with pocket money to spend. Transistor radios and Dansette record players meant that music aimed at teenagers was where the money was to be made, and the record business acted accordingly. Increasingly, albums were made for adults, singles in the hit parade were squarely aimed at youth. As time went by, other elements were added to the recipe of rhythm and blues, the simplicity and liveliness of country music, and the soaring passion of gospel.
Hey, mama, don't you treat me wrong. Come and love you, daddy, all night long, all night.
See? In the late 50s, the best pop songs were well-crafted packages still aimed at a teenage market, but often possessed of a sharp emotional intelligence.
Tonight you're mine completely. You give your love so sweetly. Tonight the light of love is in your eyes. But will you love me tomorrow?
Not only did popular songs become more sophisticated, in the 1960s it was popular music that became the voice of political opposition. It supported the civil rights movement.
Come, senators, congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't lock up the hall. For he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. The battle outside raging will soon shake your windows and rattle your walls. For the times, they are a-changing.
It was a popular song that spoke out against the Vietnam War.
And it's 1, 2, 3, what are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. Next up is Vietnam. And it's 5, 6, 7, open up the pearly gates. Well, ain't no time to wonder why. Whoopee, we all gonna die. Come on, Wall Street.
Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Yeah, what's going on? Oh, what's going on?
That America's conscience in the period of the Civil Rights Movement and the Vietnam War was pricked not by its leading classical composers, but by popular music, says something about the changing status of the two genres in the 1960s. The inescapable reality is that classical music had by this time lost its ability to voice the hopes and fears of the majority of the population, a status it had certainly enjoyed when the music of Verdi, for example, expressed the whole hopes of the Italian people for independence. It does it little credit to have let itself reach the precipice of redundancy. That's not to say that pop songs were anything like as musically complicated as the classical music they were fast outstripping in the public's affections. The sheer volume of songs composed, albums recorded, and careers launched in the blossoming of the pop age shouldn't blind us to the fact that in purely musical terms, the melodies, harmonies, and rhythms of the vast majority of those songs were both relatively limited and relatively static. Large swathes of the pop, rock and soul repertoire are variants on the basic blues template, with a straight 4-in-a-bar drum beat, a diet of between 3 and 12 chords, and a smallish smorgasbord of instruments to choose from, revolving around guitar, bass, keyboard and drums. One group who started out as a no-frills guitar and drums outfit not only became the most famous musicians on the planet, the Beatles revolutionized pop music. The Beatles' music swiftly moved from catchy but simple rhythm and blues to a sophisticated musical mix that encompassed all the styles they'd grown up with, as well as new ones they'd invented. From the beginning of their careers, they'd happily plundered musical influences from a plethora of earlier genres, like the Anglo-Celtic folk modes, or scales, in this song.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for?
or the tongue-in-cheek novelty song style of music hall in songs like this.
When I get older, losing my hair, many years from now, will you still be sending me a Valentine? Birthday greetings, bottle of wine.
The Beatles also introduced into progressive pop music such exotic innovations as an improvising classical orchestra, string quartets.
Yesterday, love was such an easy game to play.
And instruments long since consigned to the curiosity cabinet. Harpsichords.
And it really doesn't matter if I'm wrong, I'm right. Where I belong, I'm right. Where I belong.
Fairground organs. 18th century piccolo trumpets. And recorders. No other group of musicians in history did as much to expand the possibilities of recording technology as did the Beatles, often coming out with completely new techniques with producer George Martin at Abbey Road Studios. The studio albums the Beatles assembled between 1965 and 1970 are like a joyful, cheeky, kaleidoscopic journey through musical history. The message their irrepressible creativity sent out to the young at heart of the world, swimming in teenage pop culture, was that old stuff still had a role to play, that music's past was cool and interesting and fun too. They were the most unlikely saviours of old-fashioned music, but that's undoubtedly what they were.
Let's all get up and dance to a song that was a hit before your mother was born. Though she was born a long, long time ago, your mother should know. Ooh, your mother should know.
But even the Beatles didn't think to base a whole song around a Lutheran hymn harmonised by J.S. Bach. That idea was Paul Simon's in his knowingly titled American Tune. In this song, written in the months after an American planted the Stars and Stripes on the moon, Simon's patriotism is underpinned with one key ingredient, gratitude. It's something he shares with George Gershwin, Irving Berlin, Aaron Copland, Bernard Herrmann, Leonard Bernstein, Stephen Sondheim, Burt Bacharach and Bob Dylan, all the children or grandchildren of Jewish immigrants.
We come on the ship they call the Mayflower. We come on the ship that sailed the moon. We come in the ages most uncertain hour and sing an American tune. Oh, and it's all right. It's all right, it's all right. You can't be forever blessed. Still tomorrow's gonna be another working day, and I'm trying to get some rest. That's all I'm trying, to get some rest.
At this stage, it looked as if American and British rock and pop music was becoming a kind of world standard. But then traffic started arriving from the other direction, with styles from non-Western cultures vastly enriching music's palette. Once again, the Beatles had started the trend with the music of India. In the mid-70s, Stevie Wonder brilliantly adapted the street rhythms of Cuba in a series of hugely influential albums. Paul Simon then recorded in the culturally isolated apartheid-era townships of South Africa. Graceland was controversial because technically it broke a United Nations embargo, but it helped bring the vibrant music of the continent to a global audience. Since then, thanks partly to immigration, thanks partly to the internet, world music has become a bustling and flourishing reality. In the mid-20th century, it seemed as if the two traditions of music, classical and non-classical, were drifting further and further apart, as if they were speaking different, untranslatable languages. But then a strange thing happened. In America, the two zones, contemporary pop and contemporary classical, gave birth to a child that was half one, half the other. The child's name was minimalism. And the arrival of minimalism provoked a sea change in the relationship between musical genres. It ushered in an age of musical convergence, our age. Minimalism emerged quietly in the 1960s and loudly in the 1970s, spearheaded by American composers Terry Riley, Philip Glass, and most of all, Steve Reich. Steve Reich has been described as the single most influential composer of the late 20th century, bringing fresh ideas and impetus to both popular and classical music. It's a big claim, but correct. Reich derived his inspirations from African drumming and Balinese gamelan music. He found that the apparently repetitive hypnotic patterns of these drum and mallet-based musics were in fact subtly changing all the time. He applied this approach to Western music. Reich is also the godfather of sampling, whereby a fragment of recorded sound is chopped up and recycled back into a musical pattern. Sampling is the bedrock of practically every hip-hop track you've ever heard. Sampling is even more ubiquitous in dance music than the electric guitar was in the rock music of the 1960s. Its genesis can be traced to a single work by Steve Reich in 1965, It's Gonna Rain. In It's Gonna Rain, Reich takes the recorded sermon of a Pentecostal street preacher and chops up segments of it to make rhythmic cells that are repeated again and again. These techniques were then adopted in popular music, but now the exchange of ideas was a two-way street between cutting-edge popular musicians and their classical minimalist counterparts. David Bowie integrated minimalist styles from Reich and his fellow New Yorker Philip Glass into his 1977 album recorded in the shadow of the Berlin Wall, Low. Then, 15 years later, Philip Glass composed a Low symphony based on material from the Bowie album. With exchanges like this, between what used to be seen as polar opposites, classical and pop, becoming more commonplace, the split between the two wings of music is, after a century, finally beginning to close. More than anything, it's advances in music technology that have helped draw the two sides closer together. Music technology, whether for recording, amplification or editing, has developed at an amazingly accelerated pace right up until our own time, and continues to propel music in different directions, from synthesizers and drum machines to sampling, club-style mashups, and the unstoppable spread of auto-tune software, or, for that matter, playing the human voice on a keyboard. Drink to me only. But is the age of the machine beginning to get out of control? Is the servant becoming the master? The cutting edge of both fields has become unapologetically mechanized and electronic in its character, which alarms all those who cherish the spontaneity and humanity of unplugged music, whether classical, folk, or from other cultures. The danger of technological overload is articulated even by those who are most at ease with it. Radiohead's melancholic song Kid A, the product of a thoroughly convergent set of electronic and minimalist musical ingredients, uses a voice processor to evoke what might be the distressed cry of a human clone. Worrying about becoming slaves to machines is nothing new in human progress. But what the musical past tells us is that it doesn't do to worry too much about what happens next. For every movement, there's a counter-movement. For every fear, a reassuring hand on the shoulder. Music in our civilization started out as a free-flowing, unwritten, spontaneous oral tradition based entirely on the lives, loves, and expectations of ordinary people. In truth, its fundamental purpose hasn't changed in all these centuries, despite the many layers of sophistication it has acquired along the way. J.S. Bach was probably the cleverest composer who ever lived, but he gave his performers almost no instructions as to how they might interpret his sublime music. He hastily scribbled down the notes and left them to it. It is as if he is saying, "Trust me and play." We, more than any previous generation, can identify with Bach's request. We press play, and a million styles, sounds, oral colours and voices breeze in towards us as if through an opened window. We're like children with 1,000 games at our fingertips. We have, at last, reached a point where there are no wrong or right decisions about what music we may or may not enjoy. Just one gratifyingly simple instruction. Play.
Stay with us tonight on BBC HD. We've filmed drama with the new Miss Moneypenny, Naomi Harris, on the way next. A right to free education in Africa brings a mature student to school, but he's not exactly welcome. First grader coming up.